Tonight we're at the Peterborough Town Library with book author, published author, Joe Smiga.
So I decided to start writing a Western. And the Western and a dog book were written in the same year. The dog book is a true story, and the Western is a fictional novel based in the 1880s in Allegan, Utah. And it's a good story about morals and so forth and things like that. So that's where I am. And then I had a lady who is a family member, was a family member, she passed away last September. She read my first novel and she had never read a thriller before. And she called me up when she was finished the last 150 pages and she said, "How did you do this? I couldn't put it down." She says, "You need to write a sequel to it." And part of the dedication in the sequel is that book is to her. Okay, she means a lot to me. I'm sorry that she's gone. She was my wife's cousin, but she was like a sister to me and to my wife. So. But that's what started me writing. And I found out, now that I'm retired, sure I have the time, but it's something I really enjoy. And I do these presentations to try to encourage other people to write. And the world of publishing today has changed dramatically. You don't have to just find an agent, find a publisher. You can self-publish today, and we'll talk about that later. But the whole world has evolved. You can spend as few as a couple hundred dollars, or you can spend thousands of dollars as a self-publisher. Well, it depends what you want to do and what you want to get out of. But everybody has a story to tell. You know, I just talked to the story about my wife, how she encouraged me, and she still does. You know, when she finished the plot, they're reading the sequel, she said, "This is great. I even like it better than the first book." You know, that's nice and encouraging. And not just because you're my husband, she said, which is really nice. You know, so and that's, you have a story to tell. If you write what you like, or what you love, or what you're passionate about, you can write. Don't think you can't. And if you never start, and if you'd like to start, get a blank sheet of paper, sit down at the table, and write everything that comes into your head. No thinking, no criticizing, no critiquing, just write. And see what comes out. Yeah, amazing. And it can be done. I never thought I would write a memoir, but I just started. I will be writing a trilogy to the first book. So the first book, there'd be the sequel, there'd be a trilogy, and I'm gonna write a memoir. So I'm giving myself assignments, not driving myself crazy. But I'm having fun. And you can do that. So how do you develop content? You having trouble picking content? You said you like to do children's books earlier. How do you pick content for children's stories? I have no idea. How do you develop content?
It just comes up in just
whatever comes up. Whatever flows.
When I see something out there, I'll say something that,
you have a list of topics.
A lot of times the things that I've seen just have popped up. Wow, that would be interesting to write about.
It must be difficult trying to do research for children's books, though, right? Because that's sort of a spontaneous type writing.
It's pretty spontaneous.
I have a friend who, as I mentioned to you before the program started, that writes children's books, and I could not write like she writes. And it's really wonderful. She has a wonderful gift. She's got 4 or 5 books up. So, how do you, have you ever developed content?
Not so much, no.
Not so much, but you'd like to.
Mm-hmm.
Now, hopefully we encourage you this evening by saying what you like, what you're passionate about. What genre do you write? Do you write fiction? Do you want nonfiction? Right? Do you want to write poetry? Do you want to write romantic novels? There's a whole assortment of things to write. And I encourage people, if they don't know, to look at some of these writing groups around the state, like the New Hampshire Writers' Project. It's not that expensive to join. They have workshops through the course of all the seasons. And usually the workshops are based around Southern New Hampshire University. But they're starting to expand more statewide. They have various writers' meetings where writers just get together, authors just get together to at a local pub once a month. In Manchester, I would have to go to Concord. That's the closest one for me. I understand the local area is trying to get involved with them and try to get something off the ground. I know Hanover, New Hampshire has one. Portsmouth has got a group. You know, they're all over now. And that's great. That's wonderful. Because there's people like yourselves saying, how do I get this going? And then you go and talk to somebody about how it worked. What happens when you get blocked? Did you ever get blocked? No. Yeah. You ever stop and think, well, you want to write about something, and all of a sudden, nothing flows. So what do you do? My suggestion is, take a blank piece of paper again, start writing like I said earlier, and see what comes up. What you will find is that activity will motivate your mind and get it flowing. If you're really blocked, ask yourself what? Something else on my mind? Is it something else I have to do before I really can write? Right? Do I need to put this down for an hour, half a day, until tomorrow? Yes, I see the eyes going. But we all do that. And writer's block is not a sickness, okay? It's something that, as a writer, and especially if you're a new writer, we all tend to feel we're not good enough. Who's going to like my work? That's part of what creates writer's block. Because people say, I can't write. Heck, before the end of 2005, I was telling people I couldn't write. Today, I'm just sending my fourth book to publication. That's a big difference in, you know, where I was coming from 5 years ago. So it's nice to be able to say, hey, you can change, but you have to be determined. You have to say, this is something I want to do. This is something, I'll give you a classic example. My wife was never really much of a proofreader, not for other people anyway. She's got the ability, but she never cared for it. Now she likes proofreading for my book. And it's a chore to proofread, but you have to read very slowly to make sure that you're looking for mistakes. You're not getting to enjoy what you're reading. And she says she limits herself to 50 pages a day when she proofreads, because otherwise it gets too tedious. Give you, for instance, when I had her proofread, I actually sent my first book to an editor and came back, and in one of the chapters there was a telephone number listed with a Washington DC area code and a phone number. Well, I used the Washington DC area code and then created the phone number. My wife was sharp enough to go down on the internet, I say down because her office was downstairs, and look to see if that was a legitimate phone number. And then she says, you can't use this, because that party is going to get called, may get calls, and boy, they're going to be awful unhappy. Okay? Especially when you have books out in the market. So she taught me 555, 555, 1212, you know? And so anytime I put a phone number in a book, that's what I do. She also went and researched names of characters that I had. I have a lady in the first book who is the Secretary General of the UN. and I gave her a name. She went and researched that. She says, you can't do that. That's a that lady is a regular, her name is a, holds a regular political office. She said, you don't want to do that. So, you know, those are the things you have to be careful with. And so you need to get somebody to work with you, because you know what? You never find your own mistakes. And you're going to make them. No matter how good you are, I think I make fewer mistakes today than I did 5 years ago. And I keep my tenses in line more, and I've learned to put the commas in the right places. And sometimes I miss out on commas, but you know, that's what you need to do. You need to find someone who will work with you as an editor. Could be a friend if you don't want to pay for it. My first book, I paid an editor in Portsmouth independently for the publisher, because it deals with a lot of military stuff. It took me 6 months to find someone with military thriller background to edit that book. It cost me $2,400, but it was well worth it. Even though the package I bought from my publisher included editing, and they didn't take off that they didn't use that part, I did that. I also had graphic artists create the cover of that book, because people tell me covers sell books. Yes, they do. Sometimes, okay? It was a great cover. People liked it. I had lots of compliments on it. And it's moved very well. But I can't honestly say that it was the cover that did it. But with my publisher, my package includes a cover editing. So I reduced my cost a lot with the next two. So there's lots of different things you can do if you design self-publish. But most people, when they write, say, I want to sell my book, and I'm going to find an agent. Depending upon what you write, okay, and what agents you go after, and what's happening in the publishing world, it's more difficult for agents to find quality books that they're looking for publishers to buy them, because they have to sell that idea to the publisher. So they get very fussy. Give you a classic example. When I went to find an agent for the first book, I went after the five big agents that handled military thriller novels. I got five rejections. And my wife warned me when she tried to get her poetry published, this is going to happen. You don't like it when it happens, but it happened. I then took that same concept and went looking on the internet for another agent who dealt with military thrillers. There were 36 listed. They had military thriller on their resumes. And I sent them all an email, rather than spend a lot of money and just send stuff out. I sent them all an email and I said, I'm a new author. He said, the first five didn't want me because I was a new author. They're making too much money. They're not going to deal with some kind of what I call a newbie. All right? So 13 of the 36 replied they would like to see something. And some wanted queries, some wanted synopsis, so I sent them all what they wanted. I got 13 rejections. However, of the 13 rejections, I learned a lesson. Two of them were women. It was interesting because one guy sent me a rejection number, he was spelled a title wrong. So that's how much time he spent on. But one woman said, I think this is a good book, but I'm not the right agent for you. It will sell. The other woman said, this is a very good book, but I'm not the right agent for you. So you should look for an agent who will help you sell the book. That made me begin to think of the world of self-publishing. And I started investigating the world of self-publishing. In 2009, there's 1,057,400 some odd